the problem that I would like to apply my knowledge, my methodology that I described, which basically is involving the crash of the Polish government airplane, which happened in April 10, 2010, where the president of Poland and many officials died. And I'm sure you heard about it. Based on this methodology, which by the way was used also to analyze the crash of Shuttle Columbia before, and I knew that this would be good methodology to use to analyze some aspects of the of this crash. So I was waiting for the official report, and you can read in the, from the official report here, statement section 3169, that the aircraft collided with the birch tree with a trunk of a diameter 30 to 40 centimeters, which led to the left outer wing portion of about, first they say 4.7, then they measure 6.5 meters long, ripped off an intensive left bank. In 5-6 more seconds, inverted aircraft collided with the ground and was destroyed. We are talking on the aircraft Tupolev 154, which is similar to Boeing 727, which is about 40 meters wingspan and 50 meters long, about 100 tons of the airplane. So based on the on this reading, this is about 5 meters from the ground that it was measured by the investigating committee, and they say that the at this location of the birch, the airplane lost wing. And of course, when they lost wing, you anticipate that the plane would lose some of the energy, right? Because they lost balance of the lift force, so it makes sense that it goes down. But somehow then they said, because of the black boxes measured the height, that the airplane was able to go around, starting to go around without that wing, and at the location of this location, something happened, because this is the horizontal trajectory. By the way, this was supposed to be a real trajectory, but it was incorrectly directed by the ground navigation people, and they directed on wrong path. But anyway, something happened, because the plane that was flying straight turned left sharply, and at this location lost all the electric power. And that location, you can see, is about 30 meters above the ground. And this is from the Russian report. So you think about this and say, it doesn't make sense that an airplane that is going down without wing, which makes sense, now is able to go up again. And you calculate, you know, anybody can find that the airplane is flying 80 meters per second. You can see the distance in meters, so you can calculate what is the change of the velocity. And you find that in this location where you change the velocity from going down to going up, the g-force has to be about 10 g. So it is physically impossible, because even fighters cannot get g-10, right? And big airplanes, of course, with g-10 would just disintegrate at that location. So you would say that something is wrong. And then, you know, we are looking into this for many years, not only us. Recently, in Denmark, Danish expert Glenn Jorgensen made calculations, and this information is on the YouTube. His lecture was in Denmark done in January. So you can see that what he's, in fact, he had the same motivation as I had, which means I wanted to prove that the original report is correct. And I just wanted to verify that with my methodology. And he also wanted to do that. And when he put his time and I put my time, we found that the report has no sense whatsoever. So what he's saying that, okay, this is the location of the birch, and let's say the airplane lost 6 meters of the wing, and the whole one wing is 18 meters or 19 meters long. So 6 meters is about one third of the wing. And that part of the wing is flying from the left somehow to the right of the center of mass of the airplane and landed in the bushes and trees and is visible through the satellite picture. But he found also that other parts from this wing are in shrapnel shapes here. And this is the location of the first contact of the airplane with the ground. So the question is, what could happen that the other one-third of the wing is in shrapnel form somewhere in the middle where the airplane was definitely flying, because this is the mark when the airplane is touching the ground. So he also looked at the black boxes and he found that you can see in that location, a little bit before first and second debris, you can have two dips of the G-force, which could be related to loss of this wing and therefore loss of the lift force. We also found through analysis of the satellite pictures, because I have to say that until now, it is almost 4 years, no person from outside of Russia has any access to the debris of this airplane. Although it was Polish governmental airplane, but it is still in Smolensk. All the black boxes are still in Moscow, and nobody from outside of Russia has any access to the originals and can get anything out of it. There are some parts smuggled by people, which happens, but officially they are not available. So what we found that on the 11th of April, this is the part of the stabilizer, and this is the location of the first touch. This is the first touch of the airplane. And you can see the grooves that was done by some parts of the airplane in the ground. And this part from 11 to 12 of April was moved by some unknown forces by 50 meters. So we asked Russian what has happened, and they first denied that no, this was the original location. But when we presented pictures from the satellite, they eventually agreed, and they said, yeah, it was people were trying to steal those parts, and militia stopped them, and they dropped it here. So we asked, so why in the official report the new location is marked, not the original marking? And this they didn't answer already, because they said that this is a root of question. So they don't answer to root questions. To be limited by not having the access to the parts, we can rely on physics and mathematics. So what I did, I made the analysis using CFD technique and allowed this 6 meters of the wing to accelerate to a particular location in the air, and then I let it go and found so-called free path of the falling down this wing. Because it was interesting to me how it was possible that the wing that was broken on the left side can fly to the right side. Is it possible physically? And I found that yes, it is possible. You can see this is a three-dimensional path, and this is the location in the this is the center of mass location. So it goes from the location on the left and going to the right, because the flight is this way. However, in order to reach this distance, you require a certain height of the airplane. And the height of the airplane is about 30 meters above the ground. So then another scientist found that the TAWS measurements from this airplane was sent to the RAND in the United States, and we have access. This was one data point that we had direct access, and that TAWS gave different vertical trajectory than Russian showed. And again, I'm showing this original Russian trajectory that was supposed to be 5 meters near the ground. But TAFS shows that the airplane never touched this, never hit this tree at all. And it was increasing the height, so the pilots said that we are go around, we are not landing, And they started to execute this go-around decision. However, something happened later on and that disintegrated the airplane in the air. Again, coming back to Jorgensen, it is interesting because his analysis using the aerodynamics is able to go back from the location of the first mark and find the trajectory. And he independently confirmed that Taft's measurement is correct. So in other words, if the airplane would be at that location, the airplane would not be able to reach the final destination itself. In order to get there, two things must happen. First of all, the airplane must be higher, and this was also compared by Dr. Kovalechko, who did independent calculations. And from his calculation, there's 11.3 meters above the ground, which means a way different than 5 meters or 6 meters than that was stated originally, which agrees, by the way, with Taft's measurement. And also, Jorgensen says that in order to make that sharp left turn, you have to lose 2/3 of the wing. So indeed, you cannot just lose 1/3 of the wing, but you have to lose 2/3, which you can see the breeze are laying before the location of the contact with the ground. So all of that started to agree, no matter who did the calculation, either me in Akron, or Jorgensen in Denmark, or Dr. Dabacik in Baltimore, everything agrees. However, nothing agrees with the official report that was presented to the nation, to the world. So again, you can study more the available pictures from the satellite. Right now, you can buy satellite pictures for a couple of $100s. Anybody you can buy and you, from commercial satellites, and you can see the satellite picture in April 2010. This is still spring, and then in June 2010, and interesting, this is the location of called Taft 38. This is the location where the airplane turned sharply left. First of all, this Taft 38 was hidden in the official report. You cannot find it. You can download the report from internet and you can find that this Taft 38 is not there. However, if you are smart in computers and you take the PDF, you can open it, okay, because it was put a green square on top of Taft 38 because they didn't like it, because the Taft 38 not only shows that something over there happened, but that the plane flew straight. And if it flew straight, it means it couldn't lose the wing at the perch tree. It must be somewhere else. So that agrees with the Dr. Szulajinski, who is expert in explosives, and he's the alumni of the airplane department of the Polish Warsaw Technical University, that there has to be explosive in the wing that caused the middle part to deteriorate to the pieces, and therefore that 1/3 was just fly away due to the being not connected anymore to the airplane. And that happened for most likely in this location of Task 38. This is why it was hidden in the official report. Not only it was hidden, but also Russian did some work over there. They cut all the trees and all the bushes and removed about 2 meters of ground from that location, you can see from satellite picture. And again, we asked them, why did you do that? They said, well, because we didn't want next airplane to hit those trees and have another crash. So we asked, okay, but you left all these trees here. And they can be, so they said that this is a rude question and they are not going to answer. But interesting also is that you can see here, this is the location of that birch tree, and according to the Russian report, this airplane is supposed to be here 2 meters
or maybe 1 meter above the ground.
So you can imagine that all these bushes and trees should be shaved, okay? It should not be there, but they are there in June, so obviously this is not enough time to grow again in the tree. So that also confirms that the so-called birch tree is not the cause of the crash. So coming back to my methodology, you know, I, as engineer, I can build a model. And so this is a model of Tupolev 154. You have some measurements. You can see the yellow trunk of the tree according to the official report, which is the input data, right? I also had to give the properties of the material, so Professor Cieszewski from the University of Georgia, he received part of this tree from Smolensk, and he tested it, and he found that indeed this is a regular birch tree, it's not anything stronger than any other birch tree, and in fact it's weaker because it is growing in the very wet area, and therefore it has a lot of water inside of itself. And I was able to put together the properties and the dimensions of this tree. You can see how many stems, knots are in the area of crush, and every knot is the weakness of the tree. But anyway, you can see the tree itself, how it is broken and how why it was given the reason that this massive airplane lost its wing on this tree because it is broken. And so what I did as any engineer and scientist can do, I bought some of the birch tree and I tested and I created a model, an autotrophic model in this case, of course. And you can see that before my test, I used linear model, which gave the properties that I took from the literature. But then when I tested, I saw that this material is more non-linear. And I use material 143, which is part of the newer nonlinear material model available for the trees. Independently, Professor Bocelli in California did use the same material model 143 for testing of this experiment. You can see Constellation airplane, which is much older. The test was done in 65. And two electric poles are cut by the wing of this airplane. So the airplane, incidentally, is much lighter. It's half of the weight of the Tupolev. And therefore, as anybody that design airplanes, you know that you design wings according to the velocity of the airplane and its weight. So if your objective is to have an airplane that is flying much slower, which was in the case of lacking a Constellation, and much lighter, then the wing must be much lighter and weaker as well. In fact, it doesn't have, it has only two spars, front and back, and has the truss instead of ribs. So it's very light structure, and indeed, despite of the fact that this wing is much weaker, both of those poles were cut without any problem, as you can see the breeze flying through that wing. Of course, this experiment was not designed to produce data for a crash of the airplane 30 years later, but 50 years later, but it was done to analyze the spillage of the fuel. So they put more obstacles, the ground obstacles and big stones to rip off this wing to spill the fuel, to measure the fuel. And this the report of this test is in the internet, Bocelli, you can look into Bocelli's. And he used the same methodology as I did. So although we don't know each other personally, but we use the same methodology because it is available. Now, for the aluminum, we use first, bilinear material model. We use Johnson-Cook, which is strain rate dependent model, and recently we use this tabulated model, which is the most accurate that I already shown before here. So, Now, what is interesting that this test that I mentioned proves that this material is very plastic. But if you look into the field of debris, you have thousands. In fact, we got a report recently done by archaeologists that they measured, they found 30,000 of debris in certain area, not the full area. And debris are already found before this birch tree. So how the you can find the debris of the from the airplane before first contact with any tree, and also from the location of the tree all the way it is rain of parts, as I showed you that this wing part, the second two-thirds of the part, and the debris at the location are shown here through this satellite picture. Well, Dr. Szladziński says that the more debris you can get, the higher energy is involved during the damage. So we calculated, of course, and due to the fact that airplane was flying 80 meters per second, which is 270 kilometers per hour, which is not high velocity for the airplane, and landed from only 30 meters, the energy is not sufficient to disintegrate the airplane to small pieces of that nature, unless it was explosive. So the conclusion was that there must be explosive involved, and also, as I mentioned, some of the parts were smuggled out of Russia. They don't let us have, but somebody brave enough brought this piece from the wing, and you can see the typical damage from the pressure inside of the wing. You can see ripped off the rivets and a smoked internal part of the shiny part of the wing. So this is a proof that there was explosion in the wing. Again, if you look into the stress strain of different models that we used, like Johnson Cook or bilinear or this tabulated, together with the material model used for the wood, generic autotrophic model or material 143, but if you need to squash this to this level to show in the same vertical scale, you can see how weak the tree is in comparison with aluminum. I don't know if you saw, and I hope you saw, the airplanes that hit the World Trade Center the September 11 during the terrorist attack, and the airplane went inside of the building. The outside of the World Trade Center, there are steel columns. So the aluminum was able to cut through the steel columns, and that paper is written by Tomasz Wierzbicki and available from MIT and available on the internet, so you can read how it is possible that aluminum, which is one-third of the strength of the steel, can cut at certain velocity the steel columns. So of course, if the aluminum can cut steel columns, which is three times stronger than aluminum, why there's any problem to cut the tree? This is the comparison in one scale of tabulated model and birch tree. So again, coming back to our model, we used structure of the Tupolev 154, but we didn't use so-called stringers because I wanted to have my wing weaker. To be sure, to be more conservative, I wanted to have my wing weaker, and I used three stronger, no knots, no, about four times stronger than really it is. Because I don't trust the initial condition data, then I use so-called parametric conditions, initial conditions to change the velocity vectors from 77 to 80 meters per second horizontal, from 0 to 90 meters per second vertical, with the known mass of the airplane. The wedge density I changed from 700 to 1000 kilograms per meter cube, and I changed the location of the contact between birch and the wing, and different for all of that for different horizontal pitch and roll angles, as shown in here. My colleague from University of Akron, Dr. Jack Brown, he is expert in aerodynamics. He uses ANSYS CFX and calculated aerodynamic pressures. So we put those pressures on top of our loading conditions, and therefore we can show the simulations how the computer predicts what would happen if this airplane would hit that birch tree. Again, assuming that, I follow the official report. So what you can see that in each case, for every orientation of the airplane, basically the front edge is damaged, but then the birch is cut by the wing, and the airplane is flying away very quickly. The whole event takes 0.02 of a second, okay? Flight is 80 meters per second, so within 1 second the airplane goes 80 meters, right? So the contact with the birch before it is broken to pieces is just 0.02 of a second. Very quick, very dynamic situation. So you can see in every case, for every model, some of them are more linear, more non-linear, but you have the same effect. The birch tree is broken and it falls, the upper part due to dynamics has to fall in the direction of the flight. Okay, there's no other way. This was also proven by Bacelli experiment. What is interesting that in small lengths the birch is laying perpendicular to the direction of the flight, which cannot be explained physically at all. I look from the bottom of the surface of the wing and I can see that there's no contact between the lower part of the tree, again because it's so much inertia involved in a dynamic event that the wing has to just cut by, has to cut this tree and go away. So, but always the front edge is damaged. So no matter what, the front edge is damaged. I did calculations for different thicknesses of spars, different thicknesses of ribs and skin of the airplane. And in every scenario I calculated, I had the same results that the airplane, if it would hit really this tree, the tree would be cut in half, should fall down in the direction of the of the flight of the airplane, but in fact it is not the case. If you look at the debris and put together, reconstruct the airplane wing, this is the part that was flying away, but the front edge is not damaged. This supposed to be damaged part when the tree supposed to cut through the airplane. But the wing, the slot, so-called, you can see they are not damaged in that location. However, you have a big hole here. So how you can rip the big hole in the middle of the wing without damaging the front edge? Definitely not by tree, but yes, you can do it if you have explosion in this area. Then this part is just flying away because it's not connected to anything. Professor Cieszewski also recently bought some of the satellite pictures again, and he found the location of that tree with respect to other objects. This is the magnification of the tree from the 12th of April and 11th of April that we know is broken. So through the low resolution, unfortunately, satellite picture, you can see the white spot of the trunk of the birch tree, which is white, and in January 26, this tree was standing. He is the forester, he is the expert to read from the satellite pictures. He did it together with his colleagues in University of Georgia, and all five professors agreed that this is a standing tree and this is not, this is broken tree. So here you don't see any white because the branches looking from the top, the trunk, you don't see it, it's all dark. So then he found the picture from April 5. And he asked audience, is that same location from April 5 similar to these pictures or similar to this? What is your vote? Who believes that this is the same as this two? Raise your hand. Okay, who believes that this is the same as this? Raise your hand. Okay, you're right. Okay, so it means the conclusion is that on April 5, which is 5 days before the crash, the tree is broken. Of course, the official Russian says, no, this picture is same as this. So, you are wrong. Sorry. Well, I also did some simulations of a fuselage that is dropping down upside down. So you can see red floor of the fuselage. And no matter how I drop this fuselage with the angle of rotation or without, either one wall or the other wall and ceiling is broken under the floor. People from Sandia National Lab did the same calculations or calculation on behavior of fuselage. What will happen? How this fuselage will behave if you apply explosives inside? So this is shown the results in 2008 by Sandia National Lab, and the pressure from explosive rips the fuselage and opens this outside. So if you have explosion in the air, you rip off the fuselage axially and the ceiling and wall goes on both sides of the pavement. So this is one of the debris of the fuselage in the Smolensk. You can see the floor, this is the floor, this is the bottom of the airplane, this is one wall, this is another wall and ceiling. So that, to me, represents the situation that was done by Sandia National Lab, not the one that I did it before when I crashed this particular fuselage without explosives. So I did explosives as well, upside down, and indeed you can see that the ceiling and wall goes on one side and the other wall goes on the other side. And then you have the situation as captured by the photographs of the debris in Smolensk. The last analysis that I did was, okay, I'm a stubborn person, so I want to do all the calculation based on the official report that says that the airplane lost on the wing and its whole mass hit the soft ground because it was very soft, wet floor, without any stones and any bricks and any rocks. So my simulations of the whole mass of the airplane, depending on the angle of hit with the 80 meters per second, produces the crater, okay? Again, you know, you're talking about 78 tons of mass hitting 80 meters per second in the soft ground. It's normal that you can expect a crater. So the crater should be about 1-2 meters deep, and the width should be bigger than the width of the fuselage, or maybe even bigger than fuselage and wings, and it should be very long. Depending on the orientation, it could be very long, more than 100 meters long. I did this with the airplane downing with the wheels down, and later on it was shown experiment using Boeing 727, and Boeing 727 is very similar to Tupolev. You can see both dimensions and weights in the table shown in the, over here. So any accidents using Boeing 727 are very interesting. This is the one of the reports of the JFK crash when the airport, when the airplane Boeing 727 hit the lighting towers in 1975 with the left wing. You can see that the airplane contacted the top of the number 7 approach light tower at the elevation of 27 feet above, the mean low water level and 2,400 feet from the threshold of the runway 22L. The aircraft continued and struck towers 8 and 9. The aircraft left wing was damaged severely by impact with these towers. The outboard section was severed. The aircraft then rolled into steep left bank, well in excess of 90 degrees. It contacted the ground and the fuselage struck 5 other towers. The aircraft then continued to street where it came to rest. The approach light tower and large boulders along the latter portion of the path caused the fuselage to collapse and disintegrate. A fire had erupted after the left wing failed.
Okay,
so in this kind of similar scenario that was presented by Russians, however, you can read also from the newspapers that in this plane, despite of the fact that it hit those multiple towers, some people survived. 109 of 1,122 plane feared death. So about 11 people survived, including two children. You can see how these towers look. These are not just a pole easy to cut. These are steel structures, like truss structures, and one of them is completely cut in half by the wing of this aircraft. You can see the boulders over here and how big boulders disintegrated this airplane, but seats of the airplane are still intact. Well, if you compare with the Tupolev A-154, there was no boulder, there was no tower, there was just one tree, and all the airplane is disintegrated to pieces, including seats. There are no one seat that is intact. This is another experiment done by Boeing 727, done in 2012, where it was equipped with dummies and sensors without any human being inside, and the objective was to cause the explosion of this airplane. The airplane hits with the higher velocity, the vertical velocity than the Tupolev, and it breaks to 3 pieces. Of course, if you are a human being and you are flying in business class, I'm sorry, you're dead. But if you would be sitting in the middle or aft part of the airplane, you will survive. Despite of the fact that this was a very bad crash, you will survive. The accelerations are such that you will have some broken ribs, but you will survive. Well, that experiment validated my simulations, which was done before, and my simulation also broke into 3 pieces. So I could now make a simulation with upside down configuration, and I found that accelerations inside of this airplane are lower if it hits upside down than if it would hit with the regular way. The reason is that it has this tail and engines, and those tails and engines, each engine is 9,000 kilograms. It's a lot of metal, and that absorbs the energy before the fuselage is in contact, the aft part of the fuselage is in contact with the ground. So again, people in the front will die, but the aft people should survive. Unfortunately, in Tupolev A-154, everybody died. Not only died, but many people were basically found in pieces. One of the family members told me that she received in the coffin on the hand of her husband. We don't know where's the rest. So we made simulations. You can see how this crater and the disintegration of the airplane happens if it is flying upside down. You know, these are all very expensive simulations. It takes months of calculations on a good computer to get results because of the explicit nature of the calculations. What is interesting that in this case we found that at least one wing should survive. There's no reason that both wings would be damaged. You know, one was damaged because of the tree, but why the other is damaged, there's no reason whatsoever. Now, in the official report, it says that the airplane really hit not upside down completely, but kind of on the left wing, on the broken wing. So, in fact, this is even better, giving more survival chances for the airplane. And again, we can show the results of Sioux City, Iowa case, where the airplane hit the ground on the wing, rotated, you know, many times, disintegrated to pieces, landed eventually upside down, and you can see people walking outside from the middle part of the fuselage, although the fuselage is disintegrated into big chunks of the airplane. Again, you can see seats are in good shape, okay? And if people are dead, they are also dead, but they look like people. Some cases where the airplane landed upside down, in this case it was Kyrgyzstan. Apparently, Russian likes to land upside down. And in this case, you have all survived, 31 injured. This is the same airplane, Tupolev 154, landed in the forest, disintegrated into three pieces again, cut through forest, didn't lose any wing, but just sheared hundreds of trees without any problem. And people get outside. It was in the moment of this crash, 83 people were injured, all survived. Later on, two people died in the hospital. Well, this is what is left from this airplane, which you can see at the tarmac of the Smolensk airport. So this is the left wing, but look at the right wing. It's also damaged completely. Look at the fuselage. The tail was found before the contact of the airplane. So all of that can be summarized. Okay, it's one more picture to show. This is this birch, and before birch are the parts of this airplane, and all you can see all these parts that are shown here along the way of flight of the airplane. This is the part that is hanging. Before that birch, you can see the distance between birch before. So how that thing would fly after hitting the birch backwards, I cannot figure it out. Basically, the conclusions can be that a separation of one third of the wing could not cause by the impact with the birch tree. Most probably separation of a fragment of the wing was caused by explosion in the air. Lack of visible crater at the crash scene, a large field of debris indicate that the airplane disintegrated in the mid-air. And then those parts, not as a one mass, but as a rain of parts, fell down there for the didn't create any crater. Open walls outside of the fuselage indicate mid-air explosion. The unprecedented degree of damage and the large number of shrapnels indicate high-energy mid-air explosion. Without the mid-air explosion, most of the passengers in the center and in the aft section of the airplane should survive any crash from 30 to 40 meters into the soft soil. Official Russian report attributes death of the passengers to 100G acceleration. Such acceleration could be explained by explosion in the fuselage, shockwave produced by explosion, and direct impact of the passengers with the ground at 80 meters per second without any protection of the fuselage. And this is all. Thank you.